Je commence. Начинаю. Впервые мне нужно сказать, что мне очень жаль, потому что сдаю доклад по-английски, нет, по-русски. Извините. So I am going to talk about Grothendieck toposes. So this is the plan of the series of talks. So what I'm going to do is to give an introduction to different facets of Grothendieck toposes, which are especially interesting in relation one with the other. So these are the four facets I want to talk about. So the first facet, toposes as completion of spaces, is very familiar to algebraic geometers. All algebraic geometers use Grothendieck toposes in order to define cohomological invariance. So this started in the 60s with Grothendieck himself and his students, and it never stopped. So all algebraic geometers know that. But it is a fact that Grothendieck toposes have other completely different facets, especially this facet 3 in relation with logic. And this facet is not at all as well known as the geometric facet, even though it is as rich and I think as interesting. And in fact, most algebraic geometers even never heard about it. I remember that just a few years ago, I had known toposes for many years, from the years I was a student, but I had never heard about that. And after I learned about that, the relation between Grothendieck toposes and logic, I told about it to many colleagues in algebraic geometry, and most of them had not heard about it either. So this is a very strange situation where the very same mathematical objects have been studied on the one hand by algebraic geometers, on the other hand by logicians, in complete isolation one from the others. And so I think it is very good that mathematicians, especially young mathematicians, have at least an idea of these different facets. I also have to say in this introduction that I will present different facets of toposes, but it is not at all exhaustive. In fact, there are even other facets of toposes. So here, toposes are constructed from geometry. Here, they are constructed from logic. But it is also possible to construct them from so-called quantals, which puts them in relation with C-star algebras. So this is their relation between toposes and analysis, and in fact, quantum mechanics. Okay, so I want to talk about these different aspects I have put here. Here I have given names for the main contributors of the different facets. So the geometric facet was developed in the 60s by Grothendieck, who invented toposes, and his students. This was developed in the 60s and 70s by Grothendieck, and for some other aspect by Lowyer, who was a categorician. This was developed from first examples given in the thesis of Monique Hakim, who was a student of Grothendieck. So it was taken over by a whole series of logicians. I have written here a few names. I am not even sure the list of names is complete. And so this was in the 70s. And unfortunately, after the 70s, this aspect of toposes were completely ignored by algebraic geometers, as I said, and they were more or less dropped by logicians. even though I hope to convince you that this aspect is especially interesting. And this is a present development by a young mathematician, which in some way puts together the geometric aspect and the logic aspect. Okay, so...
Which semantics, what is the word for the
Universal semantics. Universal semantics of theories, and theories here in the, is in the sense of logic. All of this will become precise. The last warning I want to make is that this does not exactly correspond to the four lectures I have to give, because some chapters here will be shorter than other chapters. So I think, in point, I hope chapter two will be shorter than the other chapters. Okay. So, but for today, I want to talk about the geometric aspect. Toposes as completion of spaces. I'm going to start with topological spaces. I suppose everybody here knows what is topological spaces. And then the first thing I want to say is that every topological space gives rise to topos E, which is associated to it, which is defined as a category of sheaves on X. So I want to recall what it means. So suppose you have such a topological space, and then you can consider the partially ordered set, so poset, partially ordered set, of open subsets U of X. Okay, the order is given by inclusion, of course. And you can consider this partially ordered set, you can view it as a category. So the objects of the category are the open subsets, and the euros are associated to the inclusion relations. Every time you have an inclusion between two open sets, you decide to view this inclusion as a morphism. Okay. By now we can define. So this is definition one. We can define first what is a pre-sheaf . When I use the word pre-sheaf or sheaf, I will always mean pre-sheaf of sheaves with values in sets. Set pre-sheaf of sheaves of sets. So what it is, by definition, it is a contravariant functor on the category, on this partially ordered set. So it goes to the category of sets. So what does this consist in? Every time you have an open subset U of X, you associate to it a set. And every time you have an inclusion between two subsets, you associate to that a map which goes in the other direction, from the bigger set to the smaller set, which is called the restriction map. Okay, so this is a pre-sheaf, just a contravariant functor, so op here means you change the direction of the arrows. Okay, so this is the definition of a pre-sheaf, and by now, the second notion is the notion of sheaf. So what is a sheaf? It is a pre-sheaf, which means such a contravariant functor, such that the following properties verified suppose you have an open subset U, which you write as a union of smaller open subsets UIs, and then you have a map, you have two maps in fact, which are defined in the following way. You can consider the product of the F UIs And here, the product over double indices of F of Ui intersection Ug. And of course, you have two naturally defined maps in this way. The first map is defined by sending F of Ue to that, and the second map sending F of Uj to that. Okay? So you have the two maps, and just by the functorial character of the pre-sheaf, you have a map from F of U to this product, and in fact, it goes to the equalizer of the two maps here. Okay? And the sheaf condition is that this map is a bijection. It is one-to-one. Okay, so this is the definition of a sheaf. So what does it mean concretely? It means that in order to know F of U, so this is called the sections of F on U, it is enough to know the sections of F on the covering open subsets, plus a gluing condition. Okay, so this is the definition of a sheaf, and by now, what is the associated topos? By definition, this is the category of sheaves on X or U, if you want. Okay, so the objects are sheaves, and the morphism are just transformation of functors. Okay, so here an important point is the following. First, we have the fact that any sheaf is a pre-sheaf by definition. So this means there is a functor from this topos, the topos of sheaves, to the category of pre-sheaves on U, which I denote in this way. And in fact, with the general definition I'm going to say in a few minutes, this is also a topos. So here we have a natural embedding morphism from the topos of sheaves to the topos of pre-sheaves on X or U. And a morphism between two sheaves is the same thing as a morphism between them considered as pre-sheaves. So this means that this functor is so-called fully faithful. Okay, another very important property is that this functor has a left adjoint. So this is the left adjoint of the embedding functor. So it goes in the other way. From pre-sheaves to sheaves, it transforms any pre-sheaf into a sheaf. So this is called the sheafification functor. Okay. The last structure we have is the following. Consider our partially ordered set of open subsets, script U. Then, of course, we have, so we consider that as a category, and here we have the so-called Yoneda embedding into the category of pre-sheaves. So what is this Yoneda embedding for any object of this considered as a category? You associate to that the functor consisting of the in the morphism from the variable objects to U. Okay, so this, for any U, defines a contravariant functor that is a pre-sheaf. Okay, and then here we have the sheafification functor to EX. So in this way, we have a composed functor from any open subset to sheaves. So this means any object of the underlying category, script U, can be transformed into a sheaf. Okay, and, this is because of the existence of this functor that we use the expression completion of spaces. So you see here we have something geometric, the poset of open subsets, and you send that into the category of sheaves, which is much bigger. So, but we will see later that this category has much better properties. In particular, it has arbitrary limits, which means projective limits, arbitrary co-limits, inductive limits, if you prefer. Whereas here, of course, you don't have that. So this is, you can really think about the relation between this and that as, for instance, the relation between rational numbers and real numbers. Real numbers are constructed from rational numbers by a completion process, and here, this is constructed from that by a completion process. Of course, a categorical completion process, but exactly as in the in the case of the relation between rational and real numbers, this is much bigger. So, for instance, this is a set, okay, whereas this is never a set. It is a category, but it is not a small category. Okay, so this is the general notion of this is a general notion of topos, category of sheaves associated to a topological space. Of course, this had existed before Grothendieck. Sheaves had been defined before Grothendieck. In fact, they were invented by Jean Leray, I think in 1943. Not exactly with this definition. But what Grothendieck has done is to define the biggest environment where it is still possible to talk about notions such as pre-sheaves, sheaves, and as a consequence, categories of sheaves, which he called toposes. Okay, so this is a much more general notion, which were introduced by Grothendieck under the name site. So I will immediately give a definition, but by now I only say that this is the biggest environment where there still are sheaves and pre-sheaves. Okay, so this is by now the second definition. So what is a site? Site, C, G. So you see in the definition of a site there are two data. So the first data is a category. So here, you remember, we had a partially ordered set and we considered it as a category. Here, we consider a general category, C, plus an extra datum, which is a so-called Grothendieck topology. on C. So I have to define what is a Grothendieck topology. So the definition of Grothendieck topology uses a word which I have to define first. This is a notion of so-called sieve. So a sieve of an object est of the category C. You see, we consider an arbitrary object of the category. So what is a sieve? By definition, it is a set of arrows from arbitrary objects of the category to the objects you are considering. Okay, so here the domain of the arrows is variable, it can be anything, but the codomain is fixed. It is the object you are considering. And in order for such a set of arrows with codomain A to be called a sieve, you require the following property. For any arrow in our sieve, and for any arrow in the category whose codomain is the domain of the first arrow you are considering, then the compose morphism, which goes from C to A, has to belong to the sieve. So you mean a sieve is a sieve is a set of arrows with fixed codomain A, which is stable under level. Excuse me, it is the opposite. This is F composed with G in the other direction. So we want this set to be stable under right composition with arbitrary arrows. Okay, so this is the definition of a sieve. Okay, so by now we can define a Grothendieck topology G on C. What it is? It is a map defined on objects of the category to any objects it associates a set of sieves of A. You see, any element of this is a sieve of A. Of course, we don't consider all sieves. We consider Grothendieck topology consists in choosing for any object a set of sieves which will be called the covering sieves of the object. So you see, when you are in the case of a topological space, for any open subspace, you have the notion of covering of this open subspace by a family of smaller open subsets. The condition for a covering is the fact that the union of these open subsets has to be equal to the whole U. Okay? So here, we want to define a general notion of covering. Okay, we have to decide which sieves are covering for this topology. So a topology consists in precising, in making precise what we mean by a covering for any object of the category. So, of course, in order for this to be a Grothendieck topology, it has to verify some conditions, some axioms, and in fact, there are only three axioms. So the first axiom, here says this is such that the three following axioms are verified. So the first axiom is the so-called maximality axioms. So what it is the fact that for any A, the maximal sieve of A belongs to G of A. The maximal sieve is a covering. So what is the maximal sieve? It is a sieve consisting of all possible euros to A with all possible domains. Okay, so this is a unique sieve which contains the identity morphism of A. So you decide that this maximal sieve is always covering. So the second condition is so-called stability. So for stability, you consider an arbitrary morphism from B to A, and you consider a sieve, you consider a covering sieve of A. Then you can associate to this sieve of A, it's pulled back by F. So what it is? It is a set of euros from an arbitrary object C to B, such that the composed morphism from C to A belongs to C. Okay, when you have a sieve of A, this defines a sieve of B. And so the stability axiom is the fact that when C is a covering sieve of A, its pullback by F is a covering sieve of B.
You mean the sieve generated by this, right?
No, it is a sieve.
It's actually a sieve.
It is already a sieve. You don't need to generate, it is already a sieve. Just check it. No, but it is a good thing to do it. Okay, so you remind, of course, we are used to that in the case of topological spaces. Because if we have a cover of an open subset U by a smaller open subset UIs, and you consider an arbitrary open subset V of U, then the intersections of the V with the UIs define an open cover of V. So this is the analog of that property.
Ah, no. Sorry.
Okay, and the last property is so-called, the third axiom, is so-called the transitivity axiom. So, what it is, you consider an arbitrary sieve of A, okay, and another sieve, which is a cover, which is a covering sieve of A. So, you see, we are considering two sieves of A. One of them is arbitrary. There is no hypothesis on it at the present moment. And the second one is a covering sieve. And by now, the hypothesis is that for any euro which belongs to D, which belongs to the covering sieve, you suppose that the pullback by this euro of C is a covering sieve of the domain. So you suppose this property is verified. Then, what we want is that C itself is a covering sieve of A. In order for a sieve to be covering, it is enough to verify that it induces covers of through pullback by all errors in a covering sieve. So these are the three axioms which define the notion of Grothendieck topology. Okay, so in fact, this is, if we want, it is an extension in the setup of categories, in the environment of categories, of the usual notion of topology in the context of topological spaces. So this definition, of course, when you see it for the first time, it may seem quite abstract. One may wonder. It also may seem so general that we can wonder whether it can be useful. But in fact, experience shows that it is general enough to be applied almost everywhere in mathematics, but it is precise enough to allow for extremely rich and deep developments. So this is this definition of Grothendieck topology is really, I would say, a genius definition. And maybe the purpose of this lecture is to convince you of this fact. Alors, okay, so by now we have defined the general notion of site consisting in a category on the Grothendieck topology. And I told you that in this extremely general context, it is possible, so we consider a site, and then in this context, it is possible to talk about pre-sheaves, sheaves, and the associated category of sheaves, which will be called also a topos. So first, we define a pre-sheaf. So what is a pre-sheaf? It is just a contravariant functor from the category C to the category of sets. To any object of set of the category, you associate a set, and to any arrow in the category, you associate a map which goes in the other direction. Contravariant functor. So I write this means opposite, it just means you reverse the direction of the arrows. So this is the notion of pre-sheaf. By now, we need to define the notion of sheaf F. So what it is? It is a pre-sheaf such that the following condition is verified. So we consider an arbitrary object of the category and an arbitrary sieve, an arbitrary covering sieve. So then we observe that for any arrow in the sieve, we have certainly a map, a restriction map from F of A to F of B. This is just because F is a pre-sheaf. It is a contravariant functor. And all these arrows, when this is a variable in the covering sieve, all these arrows are compatible. So this means that there is an induced map to the limit, the projective limit of these sets. Okay, so here I have just written the fact that F is a pre-sheaf. It is a contravariant functor. And the shift condition is that for any A and for any covering sieve, this map is one-to-one. So this is the definition of a shift. A shift is just a pre-shift verifying some extra axioms. So this is a quite nice way to write always the same gluing condition. Okay, in order to know sections of your shifts on A, it is enough to know them on the domains of the rows of a covering sieve, plus some compatibility conditions. And the compatibility conditions, the gluing conditions, are expressed by the fact that this has to belong to the projective limit. Projective limit means you have a huge family of compatibility conditions between the F of B's, the elements in the F of B's you choose. Okay, so this is the definition of a sheaf, and by now, we have exactly the same structure before. So we can define this as a category of sheaves on the site CJ, okay? And of course, we can also consider this, which is a category of pre-sheaves on C. Okay, if you prefer, the category of pre-sheaves is also a category of sheaves. It is a category of sheaves on C endowed with a trivial topology. What is the trivial topology? It is a Grothendieck topology for which the only covering sieve of any object is the maximal sieve, the sieve which contains the identity morphism of the object you're considering. Okay? And we have these two categories, and these two categories are called by Grothendieck toposes. So what is a topos? It is a category which is equal or equivalent as a category to the category of sheaves on some site. This is the definition of a topos. Okay, we just say that any sheaf is a pre-sheaf, verifying some extra conditions. So this means that exactly as before, we have an embedding functor from the category of sheaves to the category of pre-sheaves. And this embedding functor is fully faithful. So this means that a morphism between two sheaves is the same thing as a morphism between these two sheaves considered as pre-sheaves. Okay, so this is fully faithful. Then, exactly as before, we have a left adjoint functor of G lower star. So this J left adjoint functor is denoted in this way, J upper star. So it goes from pre-sheaves to sheaves. Okay, so it is called the sheafification functor. It transforms any pre-sheaf into a sheaf. The fifth structure we have is exactly as before, the functor L, which is the compose functor of the Yoneda embedding and the sheafification functor. So here, if we have an object A, we associate to it the functor it represents. Yes?
About application. Are you sure it exists even if your C is not small and, say, cardinality?
No, okay, so you're right. I should have said something here in the definitions. I consider categories which are small. Or, in fact, essentially small would be enough, of course, but thank you for this remark. Yes, the categories C, when I consider a site, in fact, the category C, the underlying category we are considering, is small. It means that the collection of its objects is a set, and the collection of all its rows is a set. Thank you very much for this remark. Okay, so by now we have this composed functor. So here this is a Yoneda functor, which sends an object to the functor it represents, followed by the chiffification functor. So this is always well-defined, and it means that, in some sense, this topos can be considered as a completion of C following a long topology. Okay? When we use the word completion, there is an important question to be considered. It is to wonder whether L, so this functor from C to the associated topos, is fully faithful or not. In other words, does it define an embedding of this category into that category? Or is when you go from C to the associated topos, do you also take some quotient? So this is a question. And of course, it does depend on the topology. So, but this is an important properties of Grothendieck topologies. They can, depending on the topology, this functor may be fully faithful or not. And in fact, it can be proven that it is equivalent to the fact that for any object of C, the associated pre-sheaf is a sheaf. So it is, if it is already a sheaf, if we don't need to sheafify it, then this functor is fully faithful, and it is equivalent. So in that case, the topology G is called subcanonical. So when we are talking about Grothendieck topology, the word subcanonical means that this property or that property is verified. So this is just a definition, but this definition is important. Okay. In fact, usually it is easier to work with Grothendieck topologies which are subcanonical. But we have to keep in mind that in general they are not. Yeah, we shall see some of them. Usually topology or algebraic geometries, the topologies you are considering are subcanonical. But okay, we shall see examples later. So I will tell you later. So by now we have the general definition of a topos. So a topos is just a category which is equivalent to a category of sheaves on some site. Um, Okay, so by now we need to talk about the notion of morphism between toposes. By now, you see, we started with topological spaces. We defined associated categories, toposes, and then we generalize the notion of topos in the most possible, the greatest possible way. But of course, we also know the notion of transformation of topological spaces. These, of course, are called continuous maps. And we may wonder whether there are associated notions of transformations of toposes. So, by now, in order to do that, we have to come back to topological spaces. Let's consider a continuous map between two topological spaces. We know that this map induces a functor which is called the direct image functor, which goes from the topos associated to X to the topos associated to Y. So what is the direct image functor? So here, if we have a sheaf F, we need to associate to him another sheaf on the image topological space. So how is it defined? We have to say what are the sections of these sheaves or on an arbitrary open subset V of Y. So by definition, it is the sections of F on the pullback of V. And we can check that if this is a sheaf, that is a sheaf. Okay, so it defines a functor which goes from the topos associated to X to the topos associated to Y. Okay, and the second property is that this functor has a left adjoint functor, which is called the pullback functor. So it goes in the other direction. Okay. So this functor always has a pullback functor. So an important fact we have to say is that, you see, this is left adjoint to that. So this means that this is right adjoint to that. So as this functor is a right adjoint, it respects limits, projective limits. And as this is a left adjoint, it respects colimits, inductive limits, if you prefer, arbitrary colimits, and this respects arbitrary limits. But there is an extra fact, which is always true. It is the fact that this also respects finite limits. So here, be careful, I am not saying it respects arbitrary projective limits, but only finite projective limits. Okay? So this functor respects arbitrary colimits because it is a left adjoint, but it also respects finite limits. So this is a general fact for any continuous map F. So here there is an important fact, an important particular case. It is the case of a topological space on the point of this topological space. you can certainly consider a point as a topological space. Okay, there is only one way to do it. And the embedding of the point into the space is a continuous map. So as a corollary of what we just said, there is an induced direct image functor from the topos of X to the topos of the space. But what is the topos associated to a point? It is the topos of sheaves on the point. But what is a sheaf on the point? It just consists in deciding the set of sections of the point, and that's all. There are no gluing conditions. So this means that this topos, I should have said it before, is just the category of sets. So here, we have a direct image functor induced by any point from the simplest topos, the topos of sets, to the topos of our topological space. And there is a pullback functor from the topos of our space to the topos of sets. Of sets. Oh, excuse me, here I am thinking in French, so... So this is sets. And what is this functor? It is just a functor we associate to an arbitrary sheaf, its fiber at the point you are considering. It is just a fiber functor. Okay? What can we say? Another important notion is suppose that by now we have such a continuous map, which is an embedding of a small topological space in a bigger topological space. So in that case, this is a continuous map, so there is an induced pair of functors, okay? So let's call this J. And in that case, it can be checked that the induced direct image functor from EX to EY is fully faithful. So it is a general fact. Okay? It applies in particular in the case when this is a point. Okay, so in the case here, this direct image functor is fully faithful. So here we have just looked at what continuous maps between topological spaces induce at the level of associated toposes. And the remarks we have made, this proposition, can be used to make definitions at the level of toposes. So this is another definition. Which, of course, is also due to Grothendieck. We want to define the notion of morphism of toposes. So you consider two toposes, E1 and E2, and you want to define the notion of morphism between two toposes. So we will take as a definition what we have gotten here. So what is a morphism? It is a pair of functors, the so-called pullback functor, which is a left adjoint, and the so-called direct image functor. So this is left adjoint of that, this is right adjoint of that. So this, the direct image goes from E1 to E2, and the pullback goes from E2 to E1. It goes in the other direction. Yes? A point, just, so there is only one way to consider a point as a topological space.
No. The category of sets isn't just a category of sets.
Yes, it is a category.
No, not a category of pointed sets.
No, the category of sets. Oh. No structure at all. Only sets. Okay, so by definition of morphism of toposes is a pair of adjoint functors, the direct image functor and the pullback functor, which are adjoint one to the other. So this means that this functor respects arbitrary limits, this functor respects arbitrary colimits, but we also require that the pullback functor also respects finite limits. Okay, so this is the last condition in the definition. Why do we put it? Just because we have observed that it is verified in the case of topological spaces. So in particular, if we consider a topos, a point of a topos is, by definition, a morphism from the topos of sets to the topos you are considering. So a point of a topos is a particular case of morphism of toposes. It is a morphism of toposes where the domain is the topos of sets. Okay, so this is just a particular case of that. Okay, so by now with this definition, we just say that a continuous map between two topological spaces induces a morphism of the associated toposes. And the point of a topological space induces a point of the associated topos. The other by now we can.
We have another
question. Yes.
Okay, in your category of sets, there is a morphism from an empty set to one morphism from an empty set to any other set. Yes? I'm just trying to check what are the points of the topological space and the system of definitions. And.
When you have a topological space, a topological space is a set endowed with topology. So a point of the topological space is an element of the underlying set. But what we have just said is that a point of a topological space induces a point of the associated topos with the definition. But it is an important remark that, in general, if you consider a topological space, there is an associated topos, and you may wonder whether any point of the associated topos with this definition is induced by a point of the topological space. And in general, it is not true. So this means that, in general, there are points of the associated topos which do not come from the underlying space.
For locally compact spaces.
Yes, exactly. So this is a class of example where it is okay. So for instance, for algebraic geometers, if you consider a scheme on the associated Zariski topos, then a point, any point of this Zariski topos of your schemes comes from a point of the scheme in the usual sense.
Okay.
So this means we did not forget anything. But it has to be said that in general, when you consider an arbitrary topological space, there may be more points at this level, and the notion of points at this level is better than the notion of space at the topological level. It is better because this notion is stable under equivalences of toposes. So it is a better invariant of of the geometric object you are studying. So this is just a remark. Once again, for instance, you see, suppose you are interested in complex algebraic varieties. So, in history, people have considered only complex points of algebraic varieties. So you can consider complex algebraic varieties by looking at the set of points, closed points, points with values in complex numbers, okay, together with the Zariski topology. And if you consider the associated topos, it is the usual Zariski topos, if you consider the points of this associated topos, you have to add the points of the underlying scheme which are not closed. You see? So in this way, in some sense, it justifies the usual definition of points of schemes which are not only the closed points, but all possible points.
If I say that it is also associated with a point, if I say that this particular point of topos is also associated with a point of the space, I just enlarge the space.
Yeah. I don't understand your question. So,
for example, when the point of topos is not the point of the underlying space. So, we'll just modify the notion of the space.
No, but. You can. So, you see, in general, when you have a topos, you can consider the associated sets, and you may wonder what is the structure, the natural structure on this. And in fact, here you remark that, in fact, this was my next remark, it is the fact that the points of a topos make up a category. They are a category. It is not only a set, because more generally, if you consider two toposes, the morphism between two toposes define a category. You have a natural notion of transformation between morphism and toposes. So in particular, it is true for points of a topos. And of course, if you want to transform that into a topological space, first you have to transform it into a set. And in order to transform it into a set, you first have to replace this category by the set of isomorphism classes of points. And when you do these different steps, of course, you lose a lot of information. So, this we shall see later. Here another important notion I want to introduce just end this definition is the notion of subtopos, or if you prefer, the notion of inclusion. So when we have a morphism F between two toposes, what does it mean for such a morphism to be an inclusion? And the definition is the following. You say it is an inclusion if and only if the direct image functor is fully faithful. So this is a definition. And once again, this definition is justified by the case of topological spaces, what I had written there. So you just look at the properties you have, the categorical properties you have in the case of topological spaces, and you take that as a definition in the case of, in the general case of general morphism. And the wonderful fact is that all these definitions behave very nicely. So, of course, in order to really see that, you have to work a lot just to work with these objects. But in the following lectures, we'll progressively see that these definitions are indeed very good. So here I just want to make the remarks that if we have two toposes, then the morphism between these two toposes is, I just said it, is a category in general. Okay? So in particular, the points of a topos, which by definition consist in morphism from the category of sets to the topos, this also, the points, make up a category. Okay? And by now, we can consider all possible toposes. So what are toposes? They are just special cases of categories. The inner structure of a topos is just a categorical structure, nothing more. But toposes are very particular types of categories. And in fact, we shall see later that when a category is given to you, it is possible by looking at its properties to say whether it is a topos or not. So this means that toposes are characterized by a family of properties. And we shall see that, in fact, the properties which characterize toposes are basically the usual properties of the category of sets. So this means that toposes are just, in some sense, all categories which have the same basic properties as the category of sets. We shall see that later. So this is the subject of lecture number two. Okay, so all toposes can be considered, and what can we say about all toposes? We say, we may say that it is a so-called true category. So what does it mean? This means that in this, when we consider all toposes, it is possible to talk about objects. These are toposes. It is possible to talk about one morphism. There are morphisms between toposes. And it is possible to talk about two morphisms, which are transformations of morphism between toposes, between two fixed toposes. Okay, so the fact it is two categories just means that the morphism from a topos to another topos is not a set, it is a category. Okay, so by now I want to state, I think it is yes, a theorem. This theorem characterizes morphism between two toposes. So you consider an arbitrary topos E and another one which is associated to some site CJ. So you see here I consider a topos, I don't even precise sites which defines it, and here I consider another topos given to us by a site. And I want to know what is concretely a morphism between these two toposes. And so the theorem tells you that to consider such a morphism is equivalent to define a functor from the category C to E, which is, so this morphism we will denote F, capital F, and this morphism, in order to define a morphism between this functor, in order to define a morphism between this toposes, has to verify two properties. So it has to be flat plus G continuous. So I have to, explain what it means for this morphism to be flat on G continuous. So the easiest thing to define is G continuous. What does it mean? It means that if I consider an arbitrary object of the topos plus a family of morphism which is J covering. What does it mean? It means that the sieve it generates is a covering sieve. Here this is not an object of E, but an object of C, okay? And here, yes, I consider, I am in C together with the topology G, and I consider a family of euros to a fixed codomain, which is J covering, okay? And what does it mean? The fact that this is G continuous, it means that them, the induced family, so this is a family of morphism in E, is globally epimorphic. So this means that the smallest subobject of that through which all these errors factorize is the total subobject. So this is the meaning of J continuous. It transforms covering families into epimorphic families. Okay? So this is the definition of J continuous. By now there is a definition of flat. So I don't want to define it in general, because it is quite technical and abstract. I just want to illustrate what it can mean in cases, in more concrete cases. So first, there is the case where C has finite limits. Okay, so this, suppose C has finite limits. Okay, so this means fiber products are defined in C. Finite products are representable. So in that case, F is flat if and only if it respects finite limits. So in other words, it is so-called left exact. Okay, yes? That E on the left, so here we are considering an arbitrary topos, and so by definition of topos is associated to a site. But here we don't even precise a defining set of the topos. Whereas here we are looking, we say we are considering at a topos which is concretely given by a site. Yes, so this is exactly what I want to say. Yeah, this is exactly what I want to say. No, of course, it is the first case to be considered. It is the most interesting case to be considered.
Can you give me an example to understand such a mechanism which is not the
when you are... Yeah, I will immediately give examples. We consider the case where this topos is the category of sets. So this means that here we are talking about points of this topos. Okay? So we are looking at morphism from this to our topos, concretely defined by such a site Cj. Okay, and we want to say what it is for a morphism F to from C to the category of sets to be flat. And so J continuous, we already said what it means. Here, of course, in the context of sets, epimorphic just means surjective. Okay, but what it means to be flat, so in order to define it, we need to consider the so-called category of elements of F. So the objects of these categories consist in pairs, CI, where C is an object of the category C, and I is an element of the image of this object by F. You see, the image of this object by F is a set, so we consider an element of the set. Okay? And what is a morphism between two such objects? Okay? So what is a morphism? Such a morphism is a morphism from C to C prime such that F of E is equal to E prime. Okay, so here, when we have a functor defined on a category with values in sets, it is possible to associate to this functor a category. If you want, this category is the graph of the functor. You see, so the objects of this new category consist in pairs. The first datum is an object of the underlying category C. The second datum is an element of the associated set. And the morphisms are defined in the obvious way. Okay, so every time we have a functor defined in a category with values in set, there is an associated category. And F flat means that this category is so-called, is a so-called filtering category. So what does it mean for this category to be filtering? It means that if we consider two arbitrary objects in this category, then it is possible to find at least two arrows to a third object. When you have two objects, it is possible to send them simultaneously to a third object. So this is the first condition. And the second condition is that if we have two arrows from a first object to a second object, then it is possible to find an arrow to a third object such that the two composed morphisms are equal. When you have two morphisms from one object to a second object, it is possible to make them equal by composition with a third morphism. So this is the definition of a filtering category. And so, here there is a theorem, which is the fact that such a morphism from a category to the category of sets is flat if and only if this category is filtering. And this characterization is really a characterization you can work with. When we have a set CJ, it is possible to compute the category of points of the associated topos by using this characterization. And this, in fact, is a very good thing to do. I will immediately give to you examples. I think I still have yes, 5 minutes. I will immediately give to you examples of computations of points and I think it is a very good exercise to look at these examples and to try to compute. And when you do that, you realize that even the question of computing points of a topos is a quite, or can be a quite deep question. So, so the first example I want to give is the following. You consider the so-called simplicial category. So what is the simplicial category? It is a category where the objects are indexed by natural numbers. Yes?
There is a notion of planets for not having finite.
Yes, of course. I didn't give the definition in general. What I said here, if you want, you can take that as a definition in the case E is a category of sets. But for a general topos, I didn't give the definition. I just tell you that there is a general notion of flatness. Okay? But when you are working in toposes, of course, it is always interesting to look at morphism from an arbitrary topos to a given topos, but the first thing to do is practice is always to look at morphism from the topos of sets to a given topos you are considering, which is the category of points of this topos. So here, you see, I take the simplicial category, So the objects are just these finite sets. Okay, so this means that the objects of the category are indexed by natural numbers. And the euros of your category are non-decreasing maps. Okay? So this is certainly a category, which of course is a very combinatorial category. And so this category, I denote in this way, delta. This is a so-called simplitude category. And by now, we have an associated topos, which is a topos of pre-sheaves on this category. So you see, here I don't even consider a topology. I am only considering the not so subtle type of topos, which is a pre-sheave topos. The topos of pre-sheaves on some category. And you see the category itself is quite simple. Okay? And by now you have this topos, and you can wonder what are the points of this topos with this definition. And in fact, already this question is quite subtle. So you know that the point of this topos, as usual, is a category. So you may wonder what it is. And so I can tell you, I give you the answer to this question. It is the category of intervals. Excuse me?
The simplex category, the special category that doesn't have products, right? So you need some other definition of flatness.
Yeah, but here I define flatness when you consider. So here, in order to define that, I only need the definition I gave there. Because I am talking about points. Morphism from sets to this topos.
Oh, okay.
Okay? And so I am saying that this category is the category of intervals. So what is an interval? It is a totally ordered set endowed with a minimum and a maximum. So I really encourage you to make this computation. But I warn you, it is, in fact, quite an intricate result, already for this simple category. An interval is a totally ordered set which has a minimum, which means an element smaller than all other elements, and a maximum. And of course, a morphism between two intervals is a map which is increasing and which sends the minimum of the first interval to the minimum of the second interval, the maximum of the first interval to the maximum of the second interval. And so the points of this topos, so it is a category, and it is a category of intervals. So in particular, of course, there is an interval you know very well. So this is the interval, the real interval 0, 1. So it is certainly an interval, let's call it X. And so I'm saying that it defines a point of this topos. So this means that there is a direct image functor from sets to this topos. And there is a pullback functor from this topos to sets. So by the way, but what I should have said that, what is this topos? It is just the topos of simplitude sets. What is a pre-sheave? It is a contravariant functor from this category to sets. So this is called in topology as a simplitude set. And so here we have a morphism from simplitude sets to sets. And what it is the geometric realization functor of simply Schultz sets. Okay? But so you see, we, for instance, when you work in topology, people use a lot this functor. But with this point of view, we immediately see that, in fact, many other intervals define, any interval defines a point of this topos. So you see that the usual realization, geometric realization functor is just a particular case. As it is a point, as a corollary, we also get that this morphism is exact. It respects finite limits and collimits. And in fact, this for geometric realization functor is not obvious at all. Okay, so I think I have to stop right now, which means I didn't say at all everything I wanted, but it doesn't matter. So I will keep on next day.